Clarence Waldron, and you're at the Black Muse channel on YouTube. Tonight, we have a very special guest. He's a Stellar Award-winning gospel performer, singer, songwriter, producer, and my friend, Mr. Kurt Carr.
Clarence, always
What's up? Always a pleasure. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So the first thing I want to start off with is talking about this CD, Bless Somebody Else.
Yes.
Because they just heard that and they're wondering what's going on here. First of all, on the title song, you got everybody in gospel on this album, on that title song.
Almost everybody, yes. It was really, really a tribute to Dorothy. Dorothy was the woman who stood by my side for 25 years. We met, she got laid off. She was working for BET. And when they closed down the LA office, she got laid off. And she came to volunteer in my office for a week and stayed for 25 years. She was my life partner. We did everything together. She ran my life, literally. And she passed away suddenly of a heart attack. And it really devastated me. And from that time, I was really thinking how I could pay tribute to her. And when I wrote that song, I'd never met a more selfless person than she. And when I wrote that song, Bless Somebody Else, I said, this is her life story. So I reached out to Smokey because Smokey Norfolk was a Kurt Carr singer. People don't know that before he became Smokey. And Erica Campbell was in the choir when I recorded For Every Mountain. So that's how far back we go. And so I asked those two and then it just blossomed and snowballed. I got Wes Morgan, my nephew, Miles Caton, who he's 14 now, but he's like a viral sensation on the internet. He's been singing with me since he was three. So Miles, Wes Morgan, Fred Hammond, Faith Evans, Yolanda Adams, Smokey Norfolk, Erica Campbell, John Key, Jacqueline Carr, Bishop Morton, Zacardi Cortez, and Kiki Wyatt and Bishop Jakes all on one song. And it was, I think, a really good message leading into the pandemic that we got to help each other. And that's how we've all made it, just by leaning on our friends and people from the outside helping us and, you know, guiding us through this. So I think it was really kind of prophetic that that song came out when it did.
Yeah. So you mentioned the pandemic. How has that affected you personally? How has it changed your day, your routine?
Well, man, it really, I'm kind of a loner anyway. I'm kind of a person that spends a lot of time alone because what I do, I have to hear God. Like, people are like, how do you come up with all these songs and how do you make songs that reach people the way you do? And it's because I spend a lot of time alone and listening to God. But it got to the point where it was like, okay, now it's enough. You know, it's really been trying, not much singing, not much opportunities to travel and go out, which is really, really devastating, you know, when that's what your whole life is. But we made it through, but it's taught us to trust God even more. And it looks like we're almost on the other side of it.
Right.
With the vaccines and everything.
Right. So do you miss not going to church or are you okay with the online services?
I don't really like the online stuff. I mean, we got to do what we got to do. I mean, but isn't that what our people have always done? We've always taken, you know, our situation and made the best out of it. We made some chitlins. So we we create opportunity out of what we have. So it's, you know, amazing that we've not had to stop church, but I think it's going to make people want to get back to church even more now when this is over.
Yeah. Hey, you mentioned that just a snippet about your songwriting, you know, habits. So in the sanctuary, how did that come about for you?
No, it's crazy, Clarence. The Awesome Wonder album that it's on, we had been rehearsing for like 5 months. And we recorded on a Saturday night. And on Thursday, one of our final rehearsals, I said, I got this idea for a little praise and worship song, just a warm-up song. We lift our hands in the sanctuary and we will pray you for the rest of our day. That was the whole thing. And we just kept modulating. And it was okay. And then we went on and started rehearsing. The next day, Yvette Williams, who's the lady that sings for Every Mountain, her daughter was about 6 at the time. She said, Kurt, my daughter will not stop singing that song. And you know, kids are honest. You know, kids are like, I'm like, am I sure? They're like, yes. You know, kids are so honest. And I said, And I taught it to the band on Friday and we recorded it on Saturday. And over a million, you know, copies later and hundreds of languages has been translated into hundreds of languages, that it was just one of those things. It was just God breathed. It, you know, it wasn't anything I did or sat down and really spent a lot of time doing.
Okay.
But I thought I was crazy when I told them I got one more song the night before. The band thought I was insane.
Okay.
But God was right.
Okay. All right. And how about For Every Mountain? Where did that come from?
For Every Mountain, Richard Smallwood has a song called For This, that's called
Total Praise.
No, it's not Total Praise.
No.
I think it's called I Give You Praise.
Okay.
I give you praise. And the last line is, and it's very short. And I was going to do it one Sunday. I was music director at West Angeles Church in Los Angeles. Everyone knows West Angeles Church of God in Christ with Bishop Blake. And I wanted to do that song, and it's short. It's only like 3 minutes long. And you know, Black church, we need a vamp. You know, we need a vamp to sing for 10 minutes.
Okay.
And I was like, why do I give you praise? And I just wrote down, For Every Mountain, Brian. That was it. And that's how that song was birthed. And we sang it at the church. And I remember that particular Sunday, people were laying in the floor. People were running out of the church. It was just like such a God. Celebrities, I'm not going to say who they are, but some major celebrities were like crying and laying in the floor. It was a move of God like I've never seen before. And about 3 years later, when we did the No One Else album, I gave that song to Yvette and I wrote the front. I've got so much. I added it to the vamp, but the song For Every Mountain, we had been singing it for 3 years.
Wow. Amazing. Now,
I gotta get my best work when I don't really try too hard.
Okay. Now, you were not really raised in church per se. How did you find God for yourself? I mean, how did that journey happen?
Well, I will say in defense of my family, we were raised with godly principles. My mother was not a religious person, as we call it, religious, and not church going. We went to church usually once. Well, I would say we were CME members, Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter.
Okay.
But usually we just went on Easter. But my mother taught us godly principles. She never taught us to see people for their color or for their race, and to treat everyone right, to live with love. So we were raised with godly principles, but I just did not have the experience of church. And when I was 14, we moved around the corner from the church that we go to on Easter. I really believe God moved me to my destiny. If we opened up my back door, I could see inside the church. Hopewell Baptist Church, Connecticut.
Wow.
And one Sunday, I just asked my mother, could I go to church? By myself, I went and I started going back back and back and back. And eventually my brother started coming and my mother started coming. She had kind of gotten wounded in church, I think. And eventually she started coming to church and being faithful to church. And God used me as a child to bring my family to the Lord.
Wow. That's amazing. That's amazing. So now you also studied music at a college in Connecticut.
University of Connecticut.
Okay. Okay.
And I also studied at Hart School of Music, which is where one of my favorite artists of all time, Miss Dionne Warwick, studied. I didn't do my undergraduate there. I took lessons there. But of course, everywhere in the school is Dionne Warwick this and Dionne Warwick that. And to the point where I had posters of her in my dorm at University of Connecticut. And it was a rumor that she was my auntie. And I never told anybody she wasn't. I didn't say she was, but I didn't say she wasn't.
Okay.
And followed in her footsteps. And my mother said, if you're going to study music, if you're going to be in music, be like Dionne Warwick and get an education. And I did. And I studied, got my bachelor's in music at University of Connecticut.
Okay. Okay. Let's go back a little bit. Well, let's go forward. Andre Crouch, you worked with him. Is there a song related to Andre Crouch on this current album?
Well, I did an intro. Once I make an album, I never listen to it again. So I got to bring it back to my memory. That's true. Once I make an album, I never listen to it again. But in the intro, I do some hymns and I talk. Andre and I he was one of my mentors. And I spent time with him right up until he died. I just made time. Every time I had a free weekend, I'd go to LA and just sit by his bed and ask him questions. Where were you when you wrote To God Be the Glory? I have a wealth of knowledge from him of, you know, how his career was. And we were watching Carol Burnett, of all things, laughing. And he said, Kurt Carr, promise me that you will keep Jesus in the music. Don't sell out. Keep the name, and its name is so important to what we do. And I came up with this song, I'll Make Sure You're Lifted Up. In the beginning, I do a tribute to Andre with some hymns and stuff. So that's how that came about.
Wow, beautiful, beautiful. Now then, James Cleveland, your other mentor. First of all, before you answer my question, so did you watch the Aretha
miniseries? Yeah, I did. And that guy who played James Cleveland, spot on.
Yes.
I didn't know Reverend Cleveland at that point, but I saw the movie, The Amazing Grace movie, because I had never seen Reverend Cleveland when he was young and vibrant. So I'm glad I got to see it. That man, he, from the verbiage, the stuff James Cleveland said, to his mannerisms, he was really good. Yeah. To the lip and the lisp and his voice and everything.
Exactly. But what did you learn from him?
Amazing, because I'm from Connecticut, you know, and I just got out of music school and I was, you know, Mozart, Beethoven and all that stuff. And I learned from this man who couldn't read music at all. You know, basically played in like two keys, who just had this phenomenal feel for music. And I learned, number one, more than anything, he knew how to make music minister to people. I'll never forget Walter Hawkins saying, I'm just amazed that this man could not sing. He said, I never want to sing after James Cleveland, because he was amazing, just his interpretation of music. I learned about, he was very professional in that. I remember one time when I was playing for him on tour, I was late and I went downstairs and they were gone. I was late once, because he almost fired me for being late one time. He said, I'm going to be late to go get my money.
Okay.
I'm going to be late to go get my paycheck. I learned that from him, and how to make music minister, and how eventually I learned he could make take a song and make it his own. And in watching the Aretha docuseries, she did the same thing. They back in the day, they called it stealing your song. But it wasn't stealing, it was just interpreting and making a song your own. And that's what I think I've learned from him. I don't think my music sounds anything like him, but my approach to it and how I approach audiences and stuff is a lot. It's a lot of James Cleveland in me.
Okay, okay, cool, cool. Let's move on to something else a little bit. Still in music, your favorite female singer is a jazz legend. Tell me about her.
Ella Fitzgerald. Man, I really think she's the greatest singer. You know, her and Aretha. I mean, but you can't even compare them because they're so different. But as far as just a voice, Ella Fitzgerald was absolutely amazing. Of course, when I was young, I got turned on to her, I think maybe when I was like 15 or 16. I was all about the scatting, you know, the intricacy of that. But as I got older, it was like the tone of her voice and how she could just sing anything, like anything jazz oriented. I didn't really care too much when she started trying to be soulful, because she wasn't soulful. She didn't have soul. But as far as ability and tone, and little did I know, Clarence, my best friend, her parents lived on Sunset Boulevard, and I'd always wanted to meet Ella. I'd never met her. She lived around the corner from them, because when she died, I went to her estate sale, and I snuck up. They had part of the house roped off. I snuck up and I sat on her bed. I didn't get in her bed, but I sat on her bed in her bedroom. I was like, this is working out. And I bought some things. And this is an amazing story. I don't know if I told you, but at that time, I didn't really have a lot of money when she passed. And I bought a few trinkets. And this was actually in her home at an estate sale. And they had some tweed suitcases. And I think there were two of them, but I only had enough money to buy one. And they said, well, they make $50. They were rusted. The lock was rusted. It was the old combination lock to open it. Yeah. So they couldn't open. But because it was tweed and they were probably from the 40s, eventually they started to fray and deteriorate, and it opened. And I reached my hand in there, and there was a bag in there. Opened it up. It was some of her jewelry. So that authenticates it, but also earrings. I gave one pair to Natalie Cole, and letters that she wrote to Norman Granz, her manager. Like, treasure. Yeah.
Wow, it sounds like it. Wow. Now,
I'll never sell it. It's just, you know, to know that it was hers.
Yeah. Did you ever have a favorite song by her that you liked? Or remember the first time you heard
him? I mean, I remember being blown away by How High the Moon on the Berlin album, where she scattered, of course, but then with the Mac the Knife, forgetting the words and all that. But I think that's when I really fell in love with her. And I, as a kid, honestly, I mean, I did stuff. You know, I got, you know, I'm a Black child, so I got beat. But I never really caused my mother any problems. I never did. The worst thing I ever did was, I told her I was going on a field trip, and I took the bus to Boston to see her.
Oh, really? Okay.
I didn't even tell her until I was like well into my 40s, because she would have been again. But yeah, I lived in Hartford, and Ella was in Boston with Oscar Peterson.
Ooh.
And I took the bus to see the two of them, and I probably was the youngest person there, but I was just in awe of her ability. And you know, I don't think my music sounds like her, or I can't, definitely can't sing like her, but it's just seeing, when you see, like in watching Aretha, some things God only does once. And Ella Fitzgerald was one of those things.
Wow.
Never be anybody like that, never.
Wow. Okay, let's come back to your music now. That was beautiful. Wow. I read that you said that Kirk Franklin brings people to church, but you, Kurt Carr, you feed them.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
Well, first of all, my real name is Kirk.
Oh, okay.
Kirk Douglas, my real name. And my mother named me after the actor. And she spelled it wrong because she used to call him Kirk Douglas. And the nurse came and told my mother, you know, we should change it because it's supposed to be K-I-R-K. And I told her, she said, nah, just leave it. And I told her God knew that there was going to be two short Kirks that sing gospel. Yeah. And we were both on the same label. So of course, in the beginning, we got compared a lot. And I've always supported Kirk Franklin and what he's done. I literally had the cassette in my hand that Vicky Mack let me hear of The Reason Why I Sing. Before she signed it, she said, what do you think? I said, that's an amazing song. And so of course it was comparison. And I told somebody in an interview, it really came to me like, he's an evangelist. He goes out and reaches people in the world. He, you know, because of his swagger and his, you know, his dancing and his thing appeal to the secular audience. He can attract people I wouldn't attract. And, but once they get to church, they have to be fed, so. That's what I do.
That's what you do. All right. All right. Now, Kirk Franklin's been in the news lately about cursing at his son and all that. Do you have any thoughts about that situation or
nope. Not?
Okay. And that is all.
That was a very Aretha Franklin answer, huh? No.
Okay. All right. Moving right along. Your book. Are you, how's that coming along? Are you still trying to write it or?
I haven't actually, I'm making outlines of what happens in my life, but I would like to write a book. And when I do interviews and certain topics come up, I realize, oh, I do have a lot of experience. I tell people I watched the changing of the guard of gospel. When I started playing for James Cleveland in 1986 or something like that, We would go on tour. We'd start in Florida and end up in New York in a van, one night at a time, for 31 nights. Mm. And we would finish singing. We would finish singing and we would get in the van and drive. Each one of us would have to drive 4 hours, whatever. And I went from that to being at Gospel Centric and watching Kirk Franklin's success just totally become commercial, and we started flying first class and staying in suites and per diem. James Cleveland said, per diem, is that a French word? What would that be? What is per diem? I don't pay you to eat, I pay you to play the piano.
Okay.
I watched the changing of the guard, and with him, I met Raymond Raspberry, the Raymond Raspberry singers. I met some of the Clara Ward singers. I met Dorothy Love Coates. Of course, I knew all the Caravans, but those pioneers, I saw them. But then I saw rappers come into gospel and what Kirk Franklin did. So I watched it change.
Wow. Okay. Now,
so that's going to be in my book.
Say it again.
That's going to be in my book. And also what's going to be in my book is how you have to be nice. Listen to me, artists, you have to treat everybody cool. I had never seen Aretha Franklin, never seen her. And she came to LA because she doesn't fly. And she hadn't been there in 20 years. So everybody was there. It was at the Greek Theater outdoors. And I was so excited. I was clean. I went and got some brand new Dolce & Gabbana shoes. Brand new, they were bad too. And I'm sitting there and this man is coming by and he stepped on my brand new Dolce & Gabbana shoes. But you know what? I was like, this is Aretha Franklin's concert. It's all good. And he was like, oh my God, I'm so sorry. I said, in my head, I was like, no. But I was really nice to the dude, sat next to me through the whole Aretha concert. And during the intermission, a mutual friend of ours said, hey, Kurt. And he was like, you know that guy? I was like, no. She said, "That's Clarence Waldron from Jet." I was like, ooh. If I had said to him what I was thinking.
we would not be here today.
We would never be here today. Oh, my career might have been over because you did a cover story on me on in Ebony.
Oh God. I forgot about that. And you will remember that.
I will remember that.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, indeed. But now, so who do you listen to when you are in need, when you need comfort, when you need to hear from God? Because you don't play your music at all once you've done it.
No, I don't.
I understand that.
Yeah. So when I listen to a lot of artists. I mean, I really do a variety of them, the new ones, the older ones. I find myself gravitating to, I love Walter Hawkins songs. It's so comforting. But recently, I just been through some really, really, really tough things in the last few years. In 1 year, I buried 16 people close to me, like including my mother and Dorothy. And a lot of my friends, they go back and listen to, and they wrote down a list of some of my songs. And they, you know, they spoke to me. And that's the good thing. I'm so glad. I recently just got a letter from a singer that I know that's an amazing artist. I won't say who it was, but she was just telling me that she was ready. And I'm not even better than that story. A woman who was one of the ministers at our church, and I didn't really know her. She had 4 children. And one day we sang, "I Almost Let Go," the song I wrote. And she asked the pastor, could she go? She said, "I have to testify." And, you know, God moved to the service, and she told us in front of everybody that she had went in the woods to kill her children and herself because her life was that, I can't leave my children. She was going to kill her children and herself. And that song came on the radio. That was life changer for me. That was it. That's what it's all about.
Yeah. How about a scripture?
Music is powerful.
Yeah. It can change you. It can change the environment, change you. Yeah.
Every time I see our kids, now they're early at their adolescence. Now I tell them, I say, you're responsible for their life. You know, and that song in particular, "I Almost Let Go," was at a very dark place in my life. And it really kind of turned my career around as a writer because it was the first time in a song I had really been honest about me. Mm-hmm. That I literally was at the point of giving up, but God wouldn't let me. And I think that was what led me to know, you know what? The lyrics are so important. Because I had studied music, it was all about how intricate the songs could be. And I still do that. But ultimately, it's the message. Like James Cleveland would take a, like, "God has smiled on me." That's the whole words to a song. And he would minister to that till people would just be slain in the spirit and overcome by emotion, but also come out of their situation. So music is powerful.
Yeah, it is. Now, how about the scripture? Any scriptures that you like when you're not feeling well or not doing well? And
you know, there's one that I've been really, really been in my spirit for like this whole, especially pandemic. It's in 1 Corinthians, I believe it's 10 and 13. And it basically says that there's nothing that happens to you that's not common to man. Okay, so you ain't going through nothing ain't nobody else been through. It said, but God is faithful that number one, he won't let you. This is the scripture where he won't put more on you than you can bear. That's where that phrase comes from, that God will not let you be tempted beyond that which you're able to bear. But the good thing is that in the midst of it, he makes a way of escape that you'll be able to bear. So like, you know, during this pandemic, I'm like, I can't take this. But I remember God's going to make a way of escape that you'll be able to bear it.
Okay. All right. Last question, of course. Anything you want to share with us? Anything that I didn't ask you that I should have asked you or you want to tell us about?
No, I mean, just thank you for this opportunity and congratulations on another platter. And this is my first time seeing you. since you were sick, you look great. Look at God.
Look at God. Look at God.
Look at God, no, man.
I got a testimony. I got a testimony. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.